Namaste, I am Marici and this is the continuation of the videos where I am speaking about Rambadur Bonjon. My experiences in Nepal, in Halkoria and with the Sangha of Rambadur Bonjon prior to the attacks on my person, physical attacks and prior to the torture and captivity, 3 months, which happened in 2012. I finished my description with speaking about Andrea, how she was accepting me in Nepal, in Nyimadava Tamang's guest house, and that there were already some feelings that I will be not really highly respected by the Sangha due to her introduction. Andrea Good that time already spoke some Nepali and Tamang. I didn't understand anything. And so when I arrived with her after something like 10 days staying in the Nyimadava Tamang's guest house, we arrived to Halkoria, and this was like the culmination of all my desires and spiritual desires and my dreams to meet Rambadur Bonjon. Everyone who was or is his devotee can imagine the excitement. We all had been kept away from the real news by the Sangha. Now I am ready to say that they were just lying because of keeping his reputation from being stained, but in the same time they were breaking the principles of Shila, because every lie is breaking the principle of Gautam Buddha's Shila. Due to these lies, we were not informed, foreigners, that he already, in 2011, he already had a list of victims behind himself that time. And yes, we heard about the 17 Madeshi men, but from Europe, having read only the articles which had been distorted by the Sangha Sangha people and committees, we all thought that the 17 men were the aggressors actually, and that Rambadur Bonjon, poor boy, had to defend himself against them. It was totally the opposite, but I learned this only during 2011 and obviously later from other people and from the independent news. So those times we had been kept in legends about Rambonjon as a holy, extremely peaceful and innocent boy. And so all of us were going to meet him in Halkoria, but we were not going to meet the reality. We were going to meet a prejudiced picture, a positive picture painted by the Sangha prior to this. Of course we didn't know it, because when you are deceived, you don't know you are deceived. It's not a free choice to be deceived. So we went there with Andy and Manu, and I will not describe things which are not really connected to my what I want to say with these videos, but they were a lot of beautiful experiences, obviously. This was my first experience with the Nepali jungle, and the sounds of the jungle, and the air and the atmosphere of the jungle was amazing for me. I was even more attached to this jungle of Halkoria than to the person of Rambonjon. which it seems that he even minded, because he was used to people who come and bow to him on full prostration, like Mike was bowing to him on full prostration. But he, but I was not like that. I didn't bow to him in full prostration, and so I just stayed there and tried to do some work, volunteer work, because that was the purpose I came for, the volunteer work. So in the beginning there was already Kenpo Sonam Gyurme, who was considered an extremely educated Buddhist professor. I belong to those people who don't really know how to boast, how to advertise myself, and don't have the stomach to do that usually. But in this video I would like to speak about myself, actually, because sometimes it's a mistake when we don't show our values, and when there are values, and people who belong to so-called mlechas, people who don't see values in other people, or just titles and reputation and names, for those people it is needed sometimes maybe to just mention that I am also not so stupid and not so inexperienced and uneducated in spirituality. This Kenpo had such an attitude that everyone who was from a Western country in his eyes could not have any experience in meditation and any knowledge about meditation and God forbid yoga or Sanskrit language or Buddhism. But with this attitude it's very difficult to cooperate with someone. He started to have a big respect to Andrea Good, because Andrea is that person who knows how to sell herself, and so she waived her titles, university titles, and she brought a lot of books about a new age type of spirituality. And so seeing all these books and her laptop, she had an aura of a deeply intellectual person. But she already, before I arrived, made a kind of reputation about me that I am only her personal assistant. Even she was joking, PA. You can still find these emails in the Google group. So I was already, before I arrived, already taken just for a low level some servant to run here and there with her pens. And really she actually was using me for this servant type of work, which is this would be okay if this is not a spiritual community, and this would be okay if Rambhadur Momjon himself did not emphasize in his principles, in the earliest principles, that we should see other people as equal and we should not discriminate them according to social status, reputation, papers, titles, etc. You can still find these speeches on the internet. I was kind of disappointed that the very people who are trying to spread this beautiful teaching in the world are already discriminating according to maybe just because her university was in America and mine was in Prague. I don't know what was the reason. It was like a preventive pushing down already. You are just a servant, you are not gonna to have a say into this translation. I was a proofreader of Andrea Good's book Reflections of Palden Dorje, and I did it for free. And also this work with helping them I came to do for free. And I was very enthusiastic because I really wanted to Palden Dorje Rampa Durbomjon to have a good translation, a deep translation of his Mahapranidhana. But they didn't consider me an equal cooperator in the translations, an equal in the team. I literally, Andrea Good used me to bring cups and pens and to do this kind of manual helping, assistance work. And even when I once told her, look, I know that in this place this and this word should fit better, because I had this experience in meditation, etc. Then she told me, we had an agreement, Marici, you will be my personal assistant, so you have to keep the agreement. That was it. So Andrea Good didn't bear the presence of someone who could also share experience and knowledge about the spirituality. So this was very sad for me. Because now I would like to tell something about who I am in the view of spirituality, because I'm not a total beginner like she wanted to introduce me, but she was guessing that I might have a deeper experience. But as I told, some people cannot manage to cooperate with people of same level or even higher. They have the need to push them down. So Andrea Good was the same age like me, so there was no real reason for her to humiliate me and to use me as a servant. But I was very poor, even if I worked for an American company in Prague. My salary was one of the lowest. And it's very difficult to live in the West. I didn't have enough money to come to Nepal, and so the Google group collected money for Andrea Good, and so she was compassionate enough to use this part of this money also to help me to survive there. So due to this ability to manipulate with other people's money, Andrea Good considered herself like my boss, because I'm getting my chocolates and my shampoos and the tent from her. She arranged the tent there with really fabulous comfort. We had plastic chairs, we had bookshelves with many books, we had lamps and candles, everything. So this is something which is another topic, but it's not really needed in a meditative environment. But she told me explicitly, look Marici, we are going to live here and you are going to live here forever. Because that time the Sangha was speaking about the possibility to arrange us a volunteer visa. And I finished everything in Europe, job, relationship, and I returned the flat because I was living in a rented flat, and I really wanted to live in Nepal, near Dharma Sangha. I didn't have any other dream. And so Andrea Good assured me, and these emails can be still found in Google group, that yes, this is your next place of accommodation, you will live here. So she was very motherly in this. It was okay, I don't mind, but motherly in a way of dominating and domineering. So I tried a few times to show that in the translation process with Kempo Gyurme that I also have some knowledge, but immediately they pushed me down. Anything I told, they pushed me down. And I must say that I'm from an intellectual family, and already before coming to yoga, I had a lot of reading behind myself, and already when we were very small, we already were taught by father about geography of all of the world. And so there was some part in the translation process where we were discussing something connected to Tamil Nadu, which is a state in India. And Kempo and Andrea, they didn't know that I attended the Charles University in Prague 5 years, but due to social problems, I just the first years I was going to school, but obviously I was always a student and I had the books and I was continuously studying these matters because this was my interest. So they didn't know this, and I was not the person to boast about this. So I already at the entry exam to the university, I already had to know all the information about India, basic realities about India. And so the states of Tamil Nadu, it was nothing new for me. But Kempo Sonam Gyurme, to my shock, a professor of Buddhism, he didn't know where is Tamil Nadu. And I tried to explain him, you know, that southern state in India, it's called Tamil Nadu, a very big state. And he showed a very, very poor knowledge about the states of India. He might know about the states which are connected to Buddhism, where is Dharamsala maybe, or the states like Sikkim, which are also very Buddhist, but he didn't know about Tamil Nadu. And I was shocked. And then there was another moment when we tried to somehow put down the main religions of the world, Andrea Good, Kempo Sonam Gyurme, and me. Of course, they were the two main translators, and I was not allowed to speak out, but when they told only about Christians, Muslims, Buddhists, and Hindus, I told, and what about Judaism? Because I was a student of the philosophical faculty, we had all the basic philosophical education concerning Latin, Greek, and the basic education in Europe, it's a very high quality, and you must know about the main religions in philosophical faculties. You cannot be so stupid in a university in Europe not to know that Judaism was the oldest and most ancient monotheistic religion. But Andrea Good, to my surprise, didn't know about Judaism. She heard about Jews, but that's it. She didn't know that Judaism is much more older than Christianity or Islam. And Judaism is the first monotheistic religion of this of that peninsula. So such little details, I don't want to go to many other details, but Kempo Sonam Gyurme also showed an inability to translate Sanskrit, which if he is really a Buddhist professor, then he should know Sanskrit. So in this environment, with Andrea Good, with her New Ageist poetic translations, which were not following the reality, I started to be... there was a tension, and they let me know, let me feel that they don't accept my knowledge and my experience, and they consider themselves the only entitled translators. Yes, I must tell, yes, this was offending to me too, but my main... it was not about my pride or something, but my main disappointment was that I really wanted to make a good translation for spiritual people, not for like poems, not for artistic experience, like Andrea Good was doing it with a beautiful English, but it sounded with rhymes, but it lost its meaning. And Kenpo Sonam Gyurme, he pushed everything into his narrow Tibetan Buddhism, and many people had a feeling that Rambomjon is not a typical Tibetan Buddhist. He cannot be pushed into that category. It's much more wide. He was speaking about Hindu gods and yoga experiences, with which I myself really had experience. But this is the word like this, especially it's foretold about Kali Yuga, that people who will be mlechas, it means uneducated and unexperienced, they will be the authorities and they will lead society. And those who will be educated and experienced in spirituality, those will have to be silent and accept this. And yes, there is Kali Yuga and we are in Kali Yuga. Although Rambomjon tried to convince his devotees that we are already in the golden age. And there was one time in, I think, 2012, when they seriously believed that, 2011, that we are in the golden age. It's absurd, because it's enough to look around and to see so many other peoples are suffering, and there is no golden age now. But because they were in this cloud of ecstatic, sentimental devotion, they felt like they are in the golden age and they are loved by him. And this was already after they knew that, for example, he attacked and let me raped. So for them it's golden age maybe, but for the victims it's Kali Yuga. So according to the Hindu tradition, we are in Kali Yuga, and I will speak about this in a different video. The sad thing is that we are just in the beginning of Kali Yuga, and it will be worse. So anyone who is telling you that now we are starting to be in a golden age is deceiving you. But let's go back to this moment when I was in Kalkoria, and I was literally struggling to make the Mahapranidhana of Ram Bahadur Bomjon a quality work. Now, I must tell that apart from having a university, a little about myself, why is it so much out of place when Andrea Good was humiliating me and considering me only a servant? I was a child of an intellectual family. My parents were musicians and intellectuals as well, and all my wider family always considered education and knowledge the number one importance in life, in every area. It was about arts. Already when small children we had to know by heart every composer and writer and artist and painter, and it was like a play for us. We loved it. And geography, and my father made sure that we were already 5-6 years old children. We already knew things which at school we didn't have to study too much, because we already came to school with knowledge. And I don't want to boast too much, there are many families like this in Europe, nothing special, But apart from this, my family was secular. Because my grandfather was a very strong personality, my mother's father, for example, and he claimed that we don't need middle people, we don't need a bridge. We have a direct contact to God, and we don't need to other people to contact us with God. This was in the time where only Christianity was available in Europe, among religions. So my family was traditionally not Christian, not religious. And I also didn't really think about God, or we didn't speak about God. And then in this approach, reading only science books already before my teenage years, about biology, about science books, about physics. My favorite subject was, in all my family, astronomy. So we knew a lot about planets and space. And I was dreaming about to be a spaceship pilot. And so science was for us the most important thing. And in this environment, of course, very well fitted also. This was a communist time, so religion was anyway not allowed by the state, by the Communist Party. So in this time, I started to do yoga when I was 16. Because yoga was could survive in this communist environment only when its scientific parts had been emphasized.